Let's have some coffee first. Because today, I'm gonna do a shop update and I wanna share some of the things that are in the works here right now. So, my name is Lynn, this is the Darby Norbert channel. And as many of you know, I enjoy getting into a lot of different maker-related subjects. But from the way things go around here, I mean, we're in the midst of a lot of different projects in different stages of completion. And I thought, you know what, instead of just waiting for things to get completely perfect and done, some of these projects are a little bit larger scale, I figured, you know what, I'm just going to take this opportunity and connect with you guys, say hi, share a little bit of life stuff, what's going on, different projects, different subjects, that kind of thing. That's what I was thinking about. Let's do that. This is a book that I made a couple of years ago. This is Candide by Voltaire. And I made this as a gift for someone. I got the file from Project Gutenberg that has so many public domain books and works. I picked the paper, I printed it, I folded it. I ripped out some book boards from some old textbooks, covered it with cloth, did the whole process and thought it was so much fun. And it came out really great. Now, when I was doing this, I didn't have any special bookbinding equipment, no jigs or anything like that. And I thought, you know, one day it'd be really cool to actually make some of these traditional bookbinding jigs. It's been on kind of like the dream list for a while. So, during these last couple of months, that's one of the big projects that we've been working on here, making some really cool vices and getting into bookbinding in general, printing a variety of books. So real quick though, I can imagine that some people would be like, oh, whoa, like why would you print your own book? Can you even do that? Because yeah, you can print your own books. And I think it is kind of a neat thing. There are so many books that I want to read, and most of my favorite books are actually written before the 20th century, which means that they are public domain, so that they are free to print and you can edit and format them and do whatever you want with them. Not to mention, like, one of my goals is to actually have a shelf with books that I've selected and printed. Life goal right there. Of course, you can't beat YouTube when it comes to finding information, and I actually wanted to thank one of my patrons, Darren, who runs the Dawes Bookbinding channel here on YouTube. And his channel is very in-depth and it's been a great resource getting into this subject more. Of course, when you get into a new subject, it's always kind of fun to go shopping. So here are a couple of things that I just got. First of all, an English knife. A bookbinding hammer, and this one is made specifically for bookbinding because of the way you have to tap the spine and pull it apart to round it over. This is a real bone knife. Previously I had one made out of plastic, but this one is made out of real bone. And these are brass keys for a sewing frame that I'm making. And the round style is for the ropes, and the ladder looking style is for the ribbons. And here's some linen ribbon. And these cord and linen tapes, basically you use them to sew the pages of a book together. And in the future I want to go over, you know, the software and how I edit a book together. And I'm actually working on a rather large video in general about the bookbinding. But there are so many different areas to cover about this subject, so I thought it would be kind of cool to just share what kind of journey I'm on right now and what's in the works. So there's going to be four different jigs. Two vices, a sewing frame, and a book press. And I'm making them all out of solid hardwood and mostly using hand tools. And we decided to make this jig quite big so that it can hold a really large book, you know, if you wanted to do that. And then it has these large screws, wooden screws, which were made with this tap and die set, which was graciously lent to me by King's Fine Woodworking. He sent this big tap set in the mail, which was just awesome. Thank you so much, James, really appreciate it. Making wooden screws is rather fun. You can find a variety of smaller sizes, like I picked this one up at Woodcraft that I've been making a lot of smaller screws with. The key to cutting wooden screws is, first of all, of course, to turn the wood so it's the correct size, but then to let it soak for a couple of hours or overnight in some mineral oil. And that prevents the fibers from breaking when you're using this tool, because otherwise the threads can kind of break off and you don't get a very clean cut. But I do have to say that this whole jig here, I mean, this is kind of a prototype. Work in progress, it takes a lot of time. You test something, maybe it's not exactly what you want, and I don't want to rush it. Now, if you turn this jig around, you can see that it has a groove going down one of the pieces. So now we're going to put on the plow jig, which is designed to cut the pages cleanly. So you put the book the other way around, and then you can run this plow vise, which is another project. This is a small vise, which I used the smaller screws for here. And on the bottom side, there's a blade attached, and this is an old blade that I rounded over and sharpened. Yeah, I might use something different later on, still kind of playing around with this idea. But basically, you take passes with this, and it produces a really clean cut, as long as the blade is sharp. You have to make sure that you do a good job sharpening it. I've been dabbling around with electronics a little bit to test the quality of my air filters and to make sure that my dust collection is working at its peak. You know, the other day I was cutting on the table saw, and then I was going back and forth between the planer and the jointer, and then suddenly I realized there's a lot of dust in the air. And then I went to investigate and I realized that the bag on the dust collection had come off a little bit, so I must not have put it on properly when I emptied it. But it kind of got me thinking that it'd be interesting to monitor the quality of the air and see how, you know, if it really is dusty, see if there's a problem.
So just ran the CNC machine and then checking the amounts of dust in the air right now. And on the small end of the particles, it's not so bad. On the larger end, on the 2.5, it's a little bit higher.
So I picked up this little air particle sensor from Adafruit and hooked it up to an Arduino. And also this small display so that I can take it around the shop and around the house and just test the different qualities of the air, which has been really kind of interesting. Now the sensor puts out a lot of different data about different particle sizes, but the display can't really show that much. It's a pretty small display. So I adjusted the output to give me just enough to compare the different areas around the house and the shop. Summary from the data sheet here. Laser scattering principle is used, radiates suspending particles in the air, then collects scattering light in a certain degree, in the end equivalent particle diameter and the number of particles with a different diameter per unit volume can be calculated. So that's quite the mouthful. Basically what it means is that in this little sensor, it brings some air in, there's a laser inside that shoots there and sees how many particles are in the air of different sizes. And it was pretty quick to set this up, and I'll put links in the description to the different products and also to the code that is running on the Arduino if you would like to try to do this as well. I also added a battery to this little setup so that I can move it around and check different areas just to see if something is wrong, or also just to see, you know, how bad the quality really gets. Like if you light a match, for example, or solder, the difference is dramatic. Now, I've had an air filter on one of these box fans in the shop for quite some time. But after doing these tests, I upgraded the filter to a higher quality filter, and the difference is just quite amazing. Granted, it's like a $30 filter for a 20 by 20 by 1 inch filter, but it makes a huge difference. So the quality in the shop is quite good. In the house, it's good as well because we have good like filters in there. This shop, not quite as good, but this is very dependent on the outside quality of the air.
In here right now, there is not a whole lot of particles. It's 1317 on the smaller particles, which is a little bit high.
Just kind of interesting because, you know, if it's smoky in the air, you know that and you realize that it's bad. But sometimes if it's just pollution or something, you don't realize it. And lately it's been kind of humid and kind of stuffy. And it's really been reflected in the quality of the air, which also has been in here. So I should really get one of these box fan filters in here as well, I think. So I'm thinking about maybe making a more finished version of this project. I mean, granted, it works. I can move it around on this little particle board. But it might, yeah, I think it could be useful to have a neater, little, more cleaner unit So let me know if that's something that you would be interested in seeing. I guess the thing is you can buy, you know, different kind of sensors on Amazon, but first of all, they're kind of expensive. And then secondly, you're very limited with the amount of data that you get, whereas with this setup, you can check all kinds of things, you can check it at different intervals, and then you can do whatever you want with the data. So it's quite flexible in that sense. Plus, it's kind of neat that you can do this with an Arduino and one of these sensors. So I think currently it's out of stock at Adafruit, but I also found a very similar or the same unit at Amazon as well. Brand new tool in my shop. I haven't really talked about this tool so much yet, but it is a huge Avid CNC machine. And we've been kind of slow in terms of getting it up and running. A couple of things got in the way, but I'm happy to say that I finally did the first test cut, or the first cut for an actual project the other day. And it worked perfectly. It is so quick in terms of the cut. And this piece here is for a hammer stand, basically to hold a variety of hammers in the shop. This machine is 5 by 11 feet, which means that it is just massive. It takes up a huge portion of the shop. You can put a full sheet of plywood or MDF or whatever it is that you want to cut on it, which is one of the main things that I really wanted in a new CNC machine, is to have that capability of being able to put such a large sheet on there without having to cut it up first. Yeah, really kind of excited to get this thing going, and I want to cover this obviously more in videos coming up about the whole process of putting it together. So yeah, that's going to come up in the future. So this channel is sponsored by patrons that I just want to say thank you to. I really appreciate it, especially during these rather difficult times. It makes a really big difference. So thank you guys. And if you would like to become a patron, basically buy me a cup of coffee, that kind of thing, then you can check out the link in the description below. Oh, so I thought, you know what, we can do a little Q&A session here at the end of this video, and I can kind of answer some questions that have been coming in. And yeah, just for like future videos too, if you have questions, this would be a good place to kind of answer them. Last video, Daniel Lawlor asked, where have you been? Which is a fair question, because I kind of disappeared there for a little while. And I suppose, like, in some ways I took a little break, like a conscious break from making videos and, you know, going on Instagram, because, I don't know, the state of the world got me kind of down. And then I figured, you know what, I'm just kind of focus on things behind the scenes and kind of regroup and think about how I want to move forward. And then that break kind of turned into a longer break than I had anticipated. So that was not really my idea to begin with, that it was gonna go on for as long as it did. But anyway, I'm back now, and I'm really excited to have a bunch of stuff to share with you guys. Oh, okay. This is a question on the camera video that I did, and I got a couple of people asking, I'm curious, why do you have two cameras set up at the computer? Because I have this one right here, and then I have this one right here. And that's because this camera right here is set up so that I can, you know, film and talk to the camera. And the one that on the computer, that is set up to do in relation to Skype calls and hangouts and that kind of thing. Like if I go on like a podcast or an interview or something like that, or I just talk to my family, then I use that camera. So that they're set up in different ways. That's why I have two of them. Although the one that's on top of the computer, I also use for things around the shop a lot. Actually, I kind of move all cameras around all the time. So that's why. Oh, a bunch of people asked about the room that is in the shop that we've been kind of working on, and why not use the loft upstairs for that kind of closed space. And I guess, well, the simple answer for that is that right now the loft is a huge mess, and that's become our storage space for a lot of different things. The other thing is that while we have insulation up there, it kind of needs more insulation. It gets really hot here in certain parts. It could really use like better insulation. So if you were to use that room fully, it kind of needs to be redone a bit. I remember watching an old This Old House episode years ago, where this guy, he kind of renovated this factory, and there was this foreman's room in that factory, and it kind of looked out over the rest of his house. And I always thought that was the coolest idea, to have like a room overlooking the rest of your space. So there was something about that which was kind of neat. And not to mention, right now we're kind of working on the CNC machine. We're doing it so that the computer work is inside that room. And I think it would be kind of annoying to go up and down if you were like working and testing and going back and forth. So I actually think that having everything on the same level is kind of nice for that reason. Oh, I also had a bunch of people ask, like, what happened to the air conditioner in my shop? I guess in one video I had an air conditioner and then the next video I didn't. But it was really simple. I mean, I just took it out of there when I didn't have to use it anymore. But now I recently put it back because it's been hot here lately. Like, hot. Virginia hot. And I'm from Sweden originally. There is no such heat there or no such humidity. And even, like, Oregon, where I used to live, having this kind of heat was very rare. It didn't happen that often. And even when it did, it was really cool at night. And so here now, living in Virginia, I mean, everybody has air conditioning inside. So it's a lot easier to deal with from that point of view because you're not like uncomfortable, you can go inside. But just having heat like this is something different. It is something to get used to, I definitely think.
Hey, Darwin.
But anyway, thanks to all of you guys out there for watching. Let me know if you have any comments, you know, any questions about anything, and then maybe I'll also answer it in a future shop update. So yeah, take care, hope you're doing well. I'll see you guys soon, bye.